8,000 people lost power. As Rob said, this is all because of high wind gusts in our region, and that creates a heightened fire risk. All right, so let's take a look at some video from Vacaville, where parts of the city have been without power since yesterday. PG&E is encouraging those who lost power to unplug or turn off appliances in their homes, and they also encourage you to use coolers with ice to keep your food cold and safe. Now, we're going to have continuing coverage of the PG&E power safety shutoffs on our Facebook page. You can watch that right here on ABC, on our Facebook page, excuse me, our ABC 10 TV Facebook page.
Hey. Yeah. Sure. Yeah, definitely. Well, not dark because it lights up. Yeah, but yeah. You'll find a couple of them.
Another angle that I think might be worth it is the people who own rental homes. Because, they're expecting a lot of people to come in this weekend. So, that might be something.
Good morning, everyone. We continue our round-the-clock live news coverage on the widespread PG&E power shutoff, giving you all the latest information as it comes into the newsroom here. Thousands of California residents are without power right now. When we say number of customers, that is one home is a customer. There may be four, like in my case, five people in one home.
Yeah, so lots of people. You know, millions of people affected by this.
Millions of people affected by this.
All right, so take a listen to this.
I don't see the purpose of it. I really don't.
I don't want to sit in 5 days in a house trying to figure things to do in the dark.
It's not fun. You know, power's been off since 12:30 last night. We've got 60 pounds of ice.
They've created these conditions. It was unnecessary. Now it's time for them to do the right thing.
Okay, so millions of people are in the dark for a second day, and I don't know anybody that's happy about this. PG&E has cut power for more than 630,000 of their customers, like Walt just said. One customer could represent an entire family. Mm-hmm. And if you got more than two or three people in your family, that's a lot of people affected. All right, so take a look at PG&E's outage map. Walt, you've been talking about this all morning, haven't you?
Indeed, for the last couple of days, Kirsten, and thank you for asking. You can click on the purple dot, and it should give you information if you go to the PG&E outage map. So let's do that. If you click on, you'll be able to see the outage area and details on that. So obviously you look at this, it says, when did this outage begin? October 9th, just after midnight, as we've been talking about. Number of customers affected, 530. They list the cause, and then if you scroll up a little bit more on that, it will give you an estimated time as to when they may be coming back on, and status, don't know yet. I mean, that's pretty much how that is right now. Nobody seems to know, although I would give you one caveat, since you mentioned it. Auburn was out yesterday, and it's back on. So we were thinking whoever goes off, maybe off for
5 days.
3, 4, 5 days, 5 days max. So for those of you who, you know, may be watching us right now on the interwebs, and you're off right now, you may be back on sooner than you think. So that's the good news.
That's the good news. That's it takes perspective in something like this when everybody's so upset about it. Hopefully we can give you a ray of sunshine or hope.
I know, well, I'll say I haven't had power for the past 2 days. And I remind, this morning I woke up and I thought, is this the new normal? Is this something I'm going to have to deal with every 2 weeks, once a month? Like, I need to put this in perspective. Do I need to move or not? That's a big question.
Oh, you want to move? Asking, you want to sell your house?
I don't want to deal with this every
all
month.
The time. Yeah.
You know, I get the flip side of it, but I'm just saying, at Target, I got the last case of water, last battery case, and the last flashlight. So a lot of people scrambling right now trying to figure out what to do. And our PG&E workers, they're working in dangerous weather as well. Look, we have high winds, no humidity, and that could be an issue. So the question we really want to know, do you think these planned outages really will make a change when it comes to our fires? And our Facebook friends, when we ask them online, you can see kind of split
there's
in the middle almost, right?
Well, okay, it's split down the middle on our votes, 59-41.
That's not
but
split.
I
that's a huge advantage for no right now.
Well,
that's an 18-point advantage.
I will tell you this. I will tell you this. On our Facebook page, I don't see anybody saying so it's a little bit different when we look at the comments. A lot of people, I've seen one person say, you know what, I would rather do this than have my house burned down.
Yes.
I've only seen that perspective represented one time. I ain't going through every single comment, but I only seen it once when I looked.
Okay, so Erica says people need to calm down and deal with it. Better safe than sorry. The campfire was proof. A lot of people are also saying paradise was proof. Now, Troy, he watches all the time. He's in Stockton. He says, on the news, you can explain it however you want to explain it. You can give me the facts however you want to give it to me, but not having power is upsetting. It is costing me money, and that is true as well. $150 worth of groceries down the drain, and that's my fault.
It's hard to deal with that, and we do, and some people are prepared. I know that we just heard from one guy who said he's got 60 pounds of ice. How long is that going to last? His food? And then you're looking at that ice, you go, am I going to keep that ice to keep my food there, or am I going to make cocktails?
I know.
We got to make decisions here.
Okay, so let me give you a little perspective. You know, I'm from the South. We've had hurricanes. We have tornadoes. We have ice storms where power's out for a couple days, and this happens every season, every couple
That's
of months.
True.
We deal with this. I grew up when there was a power outage for more than a few hours. You know what we couldn't do? Open the refrigerator door or the freezer door.
Don't do that.
If you open it, it lets all the cold air out. So if you cannot, try to get some perishable. I am famous for eating like these canned tuna. The canned tuna and those bags of tuna. Where'd you think
do.
I learned that? I still do.
You still learn that.
Teach a man how to grow as a child and they won't grow.
Well, my 12-year-old would
There's a verse about that somewhere.
My 12-year-old would usually play on the computer all day long. He went for a jog. I said, oh my goodness, are you serious? So at least he was jogging, reading books. I mean, I will give you that.
Yeah, I've seen people on social media talk about all the things that they can do now that they don't have power outages. And I've seen on my own personal social media messages are like, you know, I'm finally going to finish that book.
Yeah, and I know your mama told you it was a neighborhood power outage. Maybe she just didn't pay the bill.
That's it. I'm like, my mom. He know my mom pretty well.
Rob, take it away. How's our forecast looking? When's the wind going to die down?
Oh, no, this is going so well. I don't want any part of stopping this magic moment. So let's talk about what happened in the middle of the night, because, you know, as a meteorologist and a person who lives here in Northern California, you know, I'm watching the weather and I'm watching how things play out and the time that they play out. And I'm looking ahead at the forecast models and I'm picking out, okay, well, when is it going to be the worst? Middle of the night, tonight, and early in the morning. And that's a big area, a big time frame of concern, because let's face it, most people are sleeping. You're not always on alert. There's just a lot of things that can't happen at night, or that makes a nighttime breakout of fire really dangerous and potentially worse. And that's the exact scenario that happened around 2 o'clock this morning. Now, thankfully, It was a close call, and they were able to get a handle on it. But this is what happened. You could see Oakland there. This is south of Orinda. It's a community called Moraga. And this is where a fire broke out. It was just a small grass fire, but we know other things. We know it's an offshore wind. It's dry, and it was 30 miles an hour for some of the gusts. So we knew it was going to take off, and that's exactly what happened. Then you start to look at things like Google Earth and other imagery to try and get the lay of the land. And then you see, okay, well, what we have here is your classic urban wildland interface. And firefighters know what this is, but if you don't, that's where you have wild terrain. So you've got thick vegetation, fire can easily burn through stuff like that, right next to populated areas with infrastructure. In some ways that can be helpful because you have road access, perhaps even fire hydrant access. There's things that can be advantaged with that, but also you have a lot of structures in the way. And then there's a threat to life and property immediately. And that's one of the biggest concerns. We saw the same kind of scenario happen with the Wine Country fires a couple years ago. Same level of humidity, very low in the single digits, very strong winds, and also in that urban wildland interface. So that's where that fire started. They threw all the resources at it, very close call. And remember, you can't use all your resources because in the middle of the night, most aircraft are not clear to fly at night. It's dangerous and it's also windy as well. Now, Cal Fire came to this station and gave a whole seminar explaining everything that they're working on, new things coming online, and there are helicopters that are able and clear to fly at night, which will be a great help. However, the big fixed wing aircraft, again, if it's dark, it's pretty dangerous to fly. Now, this is where it was going, and this was the big concern. Offshore winds, it's starting in this area. So you don't have to think about what's happening right now. With the winds this strong, you have to think far ahead. You have to think worst case scenario. If this thing gets out of control and takes off, what kind of terrain is it gonna burn into? Folks, look at this. There's rolling hills here. There's a number of state parks and different things like that, but you can see from the imagery, you know what's going on here. There's a lot of vegetation that's ready to go and some ridge tops. We saw this somewhat in the campfire situation where it was able to get out of the Feather River Canyon and to start leapfrogging over the terrain to more populated areas. So again, you start to connect the dots just in your imagination to realize what's the seriousness, worst case scenario, where is this thing going? And that's why they threw all the resources on it. Now, luckily, they were able to pinch it off before it was able to run into this terrain and make a run at more populated areas, i.e. Oakland, Oakland Hills, places that have a well-known history of fire back in the day. So let's talk about where we are at the moment. This is 8 o'clock in the morning. These are the current wind speeds at the airports and then some of the sensors in between filling in the gaps. Folks, it's still windy. And in fact, I'm seeing the strongest winds. You know, the biggest issue yesterday was that the winds really weren't that strong in the Sierra yet. They kicked in overnight and they're still pretty strong right now. Not in Auburn, not in Placerville, not necessarily in Oroville per se. Not see that lower elevation gap there where it's just not that strong, but once you start to move up a little bit, say up above 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 feet, that's where we're seeing some really strong wind gusts, 40, 50 miles an hour. Also closer to Fairfield, Vacaville, the coastal range, and very close to Santa Rosa as well. So again, that's where the strongest wind speeds are right now. Then we fast forward to later on today. Still pretty strong, still very dry, breezy with some strong wind gusts. We start to move into the evening. In general, we're starting to see everything relax and things get better, not worse, once the sun goes down. Officially, for the Sacramento area, all valley spots up and down, I think we're going to see much better conditions starting at 9 o'clock tonight. So that's a couple hours after sunset. And this is a change from yesterday. Just so you know, yesterday we were thinking about 5 o'clock from the Weather Service when they see their criteria for fire weather, i.e. a red flag warning. Now it's 9 p.m., so we're adding time to this. The area is still the same, but we're adding time. So really don't rest easy until a couple hours after sunset, even for the valley areas. For the Sierra, this is a big change. This is not 5 p.m. today. This is 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. So it looks like it'll be dry and windy enough that if a fire starts, because this is all about fire, it will take off very quickly. Temperatures right now in the 50s down low, 40s or so up high. And one other side issue, aside from fire, power outages, and everything else, it's just a brisk day. It does get warmer in the afternoon, 70s, but certainly as things are starting off, it is a very windy day, and that's going to continue all day long. Again, worst case scenario is imagining what happened in the middle of the night last night anywhere else in our area. Back to you.
Hey guys, good morning. Live in Nevada City, where thousands are still without power this morning. It was shut off by PG&E yesterday. Countywide, at last check, 24,000 customers are out in the dark today. A city that is actually a top tourist attraction, especially on a Thursday morning when tourists start coming in for the weekend, is now a ghost town. Businesses are closed. This is actually the only business in town that has decided to keep its store open. But take a look. It's out in the dark still. Employees here have decided to use flashlights to help customers and guide them to whatever products they need. We want to really show you what's the big concern here. Items in the fridge, in the freezer, they're going to go to waste, and they're really losing thousands and thousands of dollars. Joining me right now, Ali, you're the owner here. You know, you've been impacted, of course, a lot. You said you had to open earlier, close earlier as well.
Yeah. Yesterday, every day we were supposed to open at 6 in the morning, but today we opened at 8 in the morning. So no customer showing up, and the dairy products we had, yesterday we have thrown it out, and the cold coffee, it's not cold anymore. Yeah. So we have to throw it out, all the stuff, but it's not selling at all. And if this things remain same for a couple of days, then all the stuff like other frozen stuff and beer and this thousands of worth of stuff we have in the freezer is going to be bad soon.
Let's follow these customers here just to show and prove the point that how bad things are here in Nevada City. In this center aisle here, you can see an employee helping a customer with a flashlight. This has been happening all morning. Customers really just coming into the door and wondering if this place is open. Ali, figure-wise, how much money are you guys losing?
Usually in the beginning, like in the morning, till 10 o'clock, we used to get like $5,000 to $6,000. And right now it's been almost $300 we made so far. Because a lot of people don't know like we are open, because most of the stuff in the town is closed. All the restaurants are closed, all the shops are closed, and gas stations are closed. So only people coming over here who has like cash in hand. And so far we just made like $300. So it's less than which we are paying to the employees.
Yeah, definitely, makes it a tough situation. We also had a delivery made here earlier, vegetables or groceries. What happened there?
Yeah, so delivery is coming up, like two vendors, we already say we can't take the delivery. So they just went back, and we can't take the deliveries, and because the freezers are not working, so stuff we're going to put in is going to be bad soon.
I mentioned earlier that this is a tourist destination. A lot of people come here, especially for the weekend. It's now Thursday. When are you expecting power to be back on?
So PG&E guy, yesterday he came and he was saying like a few places going to start getting power by today. But over here, like, it's expected by tomorrow. Hope so. Things went well and we will be getting power maybe tonight or maybe tomorrow. Hope everything works as a plan, because all the restaurants are closed, and customer who comes yesterday, they booked Airbnb and they say we don't have power, we don't have nothing to eat. So people who coming over here as a tourist, they are middle of nowhere.
Ali, he also mentioned that internet is down. All right, guys, so I really want to speak to the tourist destination here and how much tourism means to Nevada City and to Nevada County. Hear this. The county generated $360 million in visitor spending last year and over $114 million in food service industry, more than 3,500 jobs to accommodate tourists here in Nevada County. Definitely a tough loss for them, an economic hit. Again, they're expecting to have power possibly restored tomorrow, maybe. It's still up in the air.
Yeah, I know that economic impact is gonna be tough for those people. Carlos, thank you for that perspective. Okay, so you know wildfires are a major concern all across California. It's not just here in Northern California. Overnight in the Bay Area, a wildfire sparked, and that forced people to evacuate. Giacomo Luca is in Moraga, where they acted quickly to make sure that fire did not spread. Giacomo, tell us exactly what you're seeing out there this morning. All right, do we have Giacomo? Give us a second. We're having a little bit of technical difficulty. We're going to wait and see if we can get Giacomo for you.
Well, Kirsten, sorry about that, everybody. It's a rude awakening for a lot of folks in this area early this morning. About 140 families they all had to evacuate as that fire, it kicked up, and it kicked up pretty quickly. It rose to 40 acres in about an hour and a half, but fortunately, there were firefighters on standby already staged in the area, ready to respond. 150 firefighters, they came in as a lot of folks were evacuating, and they were able to push that fire back and get control of it. Now, I did speak to a neighbor in the area. He said that his power was shut off. This community is one of the many communities in the region right now that has had a public safety power shut off. Police had to go out and actually knock on doors physically to let people know. But we're going to roll some sound from a neighbor that we spoke with who said that his power was shut off. And here's what he says about the PSPSs.
This was the prudent thing to do, given the weather conditions. Hopefully in the future, the utility will be better prepared so we won't have to have these shutoffs. But all things considered, can put up with the inconvenience if it saved a wildfire from starting anywhere in the northern state.
Now, the big question right now is, when's the power going to be turned back on? Well, we've been talking to PG&E officials about that for the past couple of days. We don't really have a true answer just yet because we're still in the middle of this big weather event, but we know that it's going to take at least 5 days. That's what PG&E officials are saying that folks here should prepare for. Kirsten, back to you.
All right, I'll take it from here. Thank you, Giacomo. Let's go to Vacaville. Winds really whipping just before sunrise. A fire broke out early this morning. Britt Moore was there and has more on how they quickly contained that fire from spreading.
The wind is so bad right now that the Vacaville Fire Protection District had to call in for additional resources to help them fight an early morning brush fire. It happened along Sunnybrook Lane. Deputy Fire Chief Doug Rogers tells me 1 acre of land burned. There were wood piles and brush around a house. That house itself, though, did not catch on fire. So they put this thing out relatively quickly, but they made sure to do all they could to prevent this fire from spreading.
We call more resources quicker because, as you can tell, we can barely stand up out here. So if we do get a fire established, it's really going to take off on us.
The deputy fire chief telling me overnight things were relatively calm. That's the good news there, but they say they are ready to go just in case anything else pops off later this morning.
Okay, that's Britt reporting from Vacaville. For those of you driving to Vacaville, Fairfield from the greater Sacramento area, obviously wind along I-80 is a big deal, especially if you're riding in a high-profile vehicle. All right, we're going to stop down for a couple of minutes live on Facebook. We have some business to attend to on the ABC 10 side with a continued news update. We'll be right back on Facebook Live in just a bit. Stay with us.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Rob Karlmark, part of the Morning Blend crew. And, you know, we're still seeing some strong wind gusts. I know it's not everywhere. It's not uniform. In some places like Ukiah, we've got calm winds. In Auburn and in Placerville, the wind's not that strong. But remember, this is a broad regional issue here. This is almost all of Northern California that at times will see winds strong enough with low enough humidity that any fire that starts could grow quickly. Now remember, weather is an ever-changing thing, but at the moment we are seeing the strongest wind gusts in the coastal foothill range, also on the western side of the valley, some really strong winds there. That's been continuing all night long, and also areas above, I would say about 2,000 feet in elevation, we're seeing some very strong winds there. And then once we get higher up, we're seeing winds start to calm down. So again, this gives you a rough idea of where the strongest winds are at the moment. But there's something to be said about this, because the number one issue that we're hearing about is winds are not strong in blank, so why is my power shut off? Well, you have to know that the strongest wind gusts since midnight have been really strong, and they just so happen to be in major areas where some of these transmission lines run. For example, the Feather River Canyon, we've seen wind gusts upwards of 50, 56 miles an hour since midnight. Here's another zone that's seen some very strong wind gusts. This all eventually flows down toward Folsom Lake. This is the American River Basin. There are a lot of transmission lines here as well. 53 miles an hour, 53, 46. So again, maybe not in the populated areas, but just upstream, so to speak, very strong winds. And again, a 73 mile an hour wind gust just north of Sonoma. So going forward, we do see the winds to continue to be a problem. Once we get past noon, it starts to slow down, but we're not totally out of the woods, because it should be at times windy enough and dry enough to warrant a red flag warning until 9 o'clock tonight, and then perhaps until 10 o'clock early tomorrow morning. So I know it's been a long day so far. We've got another long day with fire weather conditions. We're gonna have more updates on Facebook Live very soon.
All right, so if people are just now joining us, we are continuing our coverage of the widespread, historic, planned safety power outages that has a lot of people upset.
PG&E is shutting off power. It's a pretty dangerous fire weather. It is windy, extremely windy, no humidity. That means fires can start and spread quickly. Overnight, there was a vegetation fire in Vacaville.
We're up in arms about this. This is not the way to treat consumers and citizens of California.
These events historically are the events that cause the most destructive wildfires in California history.
Okay, so here's where we are. More than a million people are without power after PG&E cut power to hundreds of thousands of homes in Northern California. They are doing it because it's hot, it is dry, and we are seeing the strongest winds that we have seen in a long, long, long time.
Yeah, no, I've been here for about 2 years, even here in the Sacramento Valley. I'm like, ooh, this is really windy, and I know the higher elevations in different places, it's super windy. So we want you to take a look at this map. It's PG&E's outage map. Those purple dots you see there, those are the areas affected by public safety power shutoffs for PG&E. Tell us what you're seeing there, Walt.
Okay, I think we're going to click on, let's just pick some random town. Let me just scroll around, and I'm going to click on the Franciscan Village area, just because I like the name. Okay, the start time of this was October 9th, 12:37 in the morning. Restoration not available, so they don't know when the juice is going to come back on. Over 2,600 customers are affected. Now, a customer could be one home, so if you've got a family of four, you know, you're going to add a lot more people to that customer's affected area. The cause, they explain, this is the cause that's probably going out for every town, and then the status is basically wide open. We just don't know when the power is going to go back on because it's based on the winds, other factors, and the variables and the whatnots that are all part of that. So that's what's happening with PG&E to the moment. So if you click on each dot, every picture tells a story, don't it?
Every picture tells a story. And I want you to listen to this. At one point, they were talking about 800,000 customers. Remember, the key word is customers could be without power. Each customer, according to PG&E, could represent at least three people. So when they did the math, that could be 2.4 million people affected by this. That's a lot of people. And again, I haven't heard anybody happy. But here's a glimmer of hope, some good news. They had restored power to about 50,000 people in the Sierra foothills, and they expect to restore power to another 60 to 80,000 people this morning. It's 8:33. We are hoping to see that happen anytime soon now.
All right, Rob, what are you hearing?
A lot of this is going to depend on the weather. The weather has to change for the better first. Then they want to check the lines. Then they're going to make the determination. So we're still not out of the weather. In fact, and this is quite incredible to me, National Weather Service extending the time on this till 9 p.m. tonight for valley weather conditions to be dry and windy enough at times to warrant a red flag warning. And for the Sierra, until tomorrow morning, maybe 10 o'clock. Now, sometimes these change. Sometimes they drop. If something changes and the wind just isn't happening, they may look at it again and decide to drop it early. So it's not set in stone. I mean, just yesterday, in fact, I was saying 5 p.m. and it changed. It added time to both of those critical areas. But I just want to point out this. I think this is really important to understand, because as we're covering this from our perspective. This is where we live. We have our power companies. We have our own situation that's been unfolding over the last couple of days. And this is the world that we live in. But just so you know, to get a pattern like this, big things have to happen. Big ridge of high pressure, a lot of cold air draining down, drying everything out. And we're going to see the same situation in a good chunk of Nevada, also a good chunk of Southern California. And just so we're clear on this, they today will be losing power as well. I just saw a reporter standing in front of a fire station in San Diego saying, hey, San Diego Gas and Electric, covering roughly this area here, is going to cut power to about 30,000 customers. And then as you extrapolate, like you guys just did, so that may be who knows how many people. Also in Southern California, Southern California Edison, which is one of the big three in the state, they are planning on cutting power as well. So the concern is this: if there is a spark from a transmission line that starts a fire, the power company is then liable for anything that happens next. That precedent was set down in San Diego. And so that's sort of the playbook that they are all looking at. The reality is that this is a California situation that's unfolding, and we have to worry about it right here at home as well, because we're not done with the weather. So let's take you through it. These are some of the current winds that we're seeing in the area. You know, yesterday it was almost all in the coastal range and really the western side of the valley north of Sacramento. That's really where all the winds were in the beginning. They strengthened overnight. They got very strong and very gusty. We saw 74 mile an hour wind gusts near Santa Rosa. And now some of the strongest wind gusts are in the Sierra right now, but not for the whole Sierra. You know, it's not one zone. It changes in elevation, and every little canyon and pass might have something a little bit different happening. In Auburn, it's not a big deal, and neither in Placerville, where we have power outages right now. But just above that, it has been a big deal. This is National Weather Service. These are weather stations, in addition to the airport sensors, that are placed, just so happens to be, in some of these places that have seen some of the strongest winds, and very well-known places where they run big transmission lines. It's easier access. They're usually next to roads. This is the Feather River Canyon, well-known because that's the origin of the campfire, and you can see the disconnect. We did not have any strong wind gusts in Chico or Paradise more than 20 miles an hour overnight, yet where there are transmission lines which have in the past caused fires. We saw wind gusts since midnight of 56 miles an hour, 50 miles an hour, and it's not just there. It's in other spots as well. Here's Highway 80 going into Roseville. Here's Highway 50 going through Placerville. Those communities, at least nearby, power outages right now. Wind speeds, not an issue whatsoever. But once you get into the higher elevations and certainly closer to some of these canyons, these narrow canyons, and below some of these hydro dams, we're looking at transmission lines that were affected by 53 mile an hour gusts, 46 mile an hour wind gusts. They have their own criteria of when they decide that the wind is too much for their concerns for safety. I can just tell you that that's what's going on with the weather since midnight. We have seen, not everywhere, but in critical places where there just so happens to be transmission lines, very, very strong winds. There's that 73 mile an hour wind gust just north there of Calistoga. If you want to know what the grid is, that's the grid. That is a mess. It's a patchwork of all sorts of different companies running lines to and fro. But most of these in Northern California happen to be run and operated and owned by PG&E. They also happen to go through areas that are most affected by the wind by nature of the terrain. Let me give you an example. We've got a bunch of hydro power plants up and down the Sierra. They capture water, they're good for recreation, but at almost all of these waterways up high, lakes and reservoirs, there's a dam at the bottom. The water flows through, it generates electricity. Then you have to get the electricity to the customers, and that's where these big transmission lines weave their way through portions of the Sierra. If at any point along these lines you see strong wind gusts that could compromise that line, it's up to them. They make the call, and if it's shut off there, then the power may not be coming to you. So again, the grid is very complicated. It's usually happening far away from where people live. But to point out that example one more time, Feather River Canyon, when that fire broke out, the winds there were 60 miles an hour plus and not bad at all in Paradise, and we know what happened next. So again, it's a disconnect. The weather at your house does not matter as much as the weather that's happening near these transmission lines. 50 degrees in Marysville right now, 54 in Modesto, and 40s and 20s up high. In the middle of all this, we've cooled down a lot, and we're gonna have another day in the 70s, and the wind speed, this is critical, hour by hour, we do see, in general, things getting better, not worse, in the hours ahead, especially close to sunset and a little bit past that for valley spots, and ultimately, the Sierra will be thrown in that as well. Brittany?
Good updates, Rob Karlmark. I'm without power, so I'm listening to every update you have. As you head into work today, keep in mind traffic lights are out in a lot of neighborhoods. Now, police in Santa Rosa are telling us they responded to several accidents at intersections where the power was out. They say slow down and treat all intersections as four-way stops. And even if your neighborhood does have power, all the wind could bring down trees and power lines. So take it nice and slow because you truly never know what's going to happen on our roadways. Police in Auburn are also doing extra patrols in areas without power. They're seeing a lot of people driving erratically on our roadways. They want people to know to take it nice and slow. And just because the power is out doesn't give you an excuse to drive crazy. Of course, we will update you on TV and online. And Kirsten, a couple places in Auburn without gas. I'm going to bring you an update in that area as well. So a lot going on.
Oh, yeah, it is a lot going on. But we got you back. 840 right now. We want to take you down to El Dorado County now, where more than 50,000 people are without power. Now, a lot of them have been without power for more than a day now, a full day. Hank Cavanaro was in Placerville, where there's still a lot going on, even with the lights out.
Are you guys having a good Wednesday night in the darkness?
Even with the lights off, some in Placerville are finding their way to enjoy their nights.
Yeah, we keep it lit even when it's not, you know what I'm saying?
As they look for a spark of normalcy.
Well, Wednesday nights are always karaoke here.
I've seen trouble all my days.
And the fact that they still did it on a blackout is pretty extraordinary.
Yeah, and you know, we wanted to be upset and mad about it, but we decided to embrace it. We might have to do a blackout Wednesday once a month.
Owner Al Griffin knew people needed a place to come together.
In this world.
People like Neil Fruzo.
This is my place, man. This is my home. Woo-hoo!
And across the street, Bene's Italian restaurant also kept the lights on.
So we went to Plan B, which is almost like survival mode.
Bringing a different atmosphere. But people still looking for normal.
A couple of days without power, I can deal with that.
So whether you prefer the quiet, or karaoke, everyone is looking for the light inside the darkness.
We created a family here.
Hank Cavanaro, ABC 10.
All right, so you need to know this. PG&E has resource centers that are free for people in the communities who have been affected by the power shutoffs. These are free places that you can go, take a break, use the restroom, charge your phone, and get some AC if you need that. They have room for 100 people at every single location. They're open from 8 until 6 every day for as long as these outages last. If you need a full list of the locations, you can find that on our website, abc10.com, where we have a whole lot of resources for you, Walt.
A whole lot of. Okay, thank you, Kirsten. The city has two water treatment plants, and one of them is affected by the PG&E utility shutoffs. And we are talking about, which city are we talking about? The city has two water treatment plants, one Fairfield. One of them is affected by PG&E power shutoffs. Fortunately, it has a battery backup generator. That means it's working at only about 50%. City officials in Fairfield say the water is safe to drink, but they're asking you to conserve water whenever possible. We talked to Lieutenant Josiah Jacobson with the Fairfield PD about the situation.
The biggest part we would ask is your lawns, your landscaping, they'll survive. So please don't use water for landscaping. It's not something that's needed. Use it for what you need for cooking, cleaning, and things of that nature. And if everybody does that, that'll obviously change the amount of water that's being consumed, and that's the conservation that we just want everyone to try to think of.
All right, let's go on to Calaveras County. This water district has spent months getting ready for a potential shutoff. They have backup generators across the area, but they're also asking people to conserve water as much as possible. Don't wash your cars, fill up your pool, or water your lawn. Don't do any of that. And only flush the toilet when necessary. Brittany.
Tips. All right, so these outages are affecting thousands of kids in the area. More schools will be closed today because they don't have power. So the whole Grass Valley School District is canceling classes and after school programs. There'll be no classes at Folsom Lake Community College's Placerville campus. Espartos Unified School District are also closed. And new overnight, UC Berkeley is canceling classes for a second straight day. Of course, we have your back anytime you need it. You can get the latest information on closures and everything else you need to know at abc10.com and on our app. We are going to be updating you around the clock.
Brittany, thank you so much for that. Let's go back to our question of the day. Do you think the planned outages are helping prevent wildfires? You can vote on the ABC 10 app or go to the abc10.com/vote area. So there is the sign that says abc10.com, and we would love for you to consider the PG&E shutoffs situation. That's kind of been the big debatable thing all day, wouldn't you say?
Yeah. Let me tell you what people are saying. Johnny Flores says, now's the time to go solar with a battery. Who's with me? Cherie says she's watching from Clear Lake, California. Hey, girl. Hey, thank you so much. I know that Clear Lake was one of those cities that we zoomed in on.
It was Lakeport,
right? There we go. And we saw what it looked like before the lights went out and then after. And at nighttime, that's really dark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'll just say, for me, I have no power to second day. I went to Target last night. I literally got the last case of water.
Okay.
I literally got the last flashlight, which I overpaid $34.
That's
so
amazing.
Bitter about
it must
that.
Be a good flashlight.
Was it a good?
It is a good one.
It better be a good flashlight.
When you need a flashlight, it's a good flashlight
when you
have one.
Exactly. I had to take a bath by flashlight today. And then I got the battery cell phone chargers as well, the last two of that. So now we're prepared. I feel foolish that I wasn't prepared ahead of time, but now I know.
I think that's really interesting perspective, Brittany. I want to hear a little bit more about what your family is having to do to cope with the power outages, because I'm on SMUD, so I'm not really affected. What are you guys going through?
Okay, so here's my deal. I told this to you guys earlier today. I was like, you know what? One or two days, I get that. That's fine when you think about the big picture. But if it's going to happen like once every month, once every 2 weeks, then I'm going to start questioning, should I move? Because I live, in the hills, maybe I need to go a little bit closer. I don't want to deal with it all the time. I mean, does that make me sound ridiculous?
No, the governor wants you to be outraged, and you're clearly outraged. So there you go.
But understandably so, you shouldn't have to put up with something like this.
You know, there is some way to answer that.
Yeah.
The last time that we saw conditions like this for as long-lasting, wind, the dryness of the air was a couple years ago. So if this happens every couple of years...
Then, yeah, that's fine.
Everyone's going to have their breaking point. For some people, especially, they've already had a couple power outage shutoffs. Maybe not in El Dorado Hills, but, certainly Placerville, some areas. it's going to happen more in some of those spots in some of the rural areas near Grass Valley, Nevada City. And for some of those communities, I mean, this is just not a way of life that anybody signed up for.
No. I think you're right. Plus, if you want to buy a home in El Dorado Hills, there's one you can get a good deal on today.
I was like, Brittany, is it? Right? I don't know.
And you know what? A good flashlight comes with a home.
She's going to put that in the price, though. Yeah. Put that in the price. Y'all.
Okay, so we'll be back on, right? Rob, we're not going anywhere, right?
No,
okay.
At 9 o'clock, we're going to be on TV.
On the TV side, and that's coming up in just 13 minutes. All right, plan to coverage all day long on all our platforms, online and on air, abc10.com and on ABC 10 TV. We'll be right back.
Get up-to-the-minute information during the largest planned power outage in state history, affecting 800,000 customers in more than 30 counties. Be the first to know breaking updates and alerts delivered straight to your phone. Download the ABC 10 News app now.